Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you'll share it with a friend. Ezra was born in captivity. His parents must have been godly people because their son loved the Lord and wanted to become a priest so he could travel to Jerusalem to reestablish the rabbinical system and restore the Torah teaching to the people. King Artaxerxes I commissioned Ezra to aid in the rebuilding of the temple and set up the justice system in Judea. Ezra asked God for protection because their small caravan carried a lot of gold and silver for the temple, and they made it to Jerusalem unmolested by robbers. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Praise the Lord, and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church Worldwide. And we're going to look upon a message today, Pagan Wives. It's going to be a difficult message for you to hear and to understand. But in the book of Ezra, we're going to talk about these events are going to be paralleling into our time as we are getting in close to the end times. So let's do this. Those are the chapters. Would you stand with me as we're going to pray? Heavenly Father, I want to thank you and praise you right now for this Sunday morning. Thank you, Father God, for giving me the insight, the strength, the anointing to present this message in such a way that people will understand it. And not only understand it, but they, Father God, that we implement things in our lives. And I thank and I praise you for that now. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. You may be seated. If you got a Bible, we're going to turn to Ezra chapter 7. That's where we're going to start today. Ezra chapter 7. And we're going to talk about the second return. The Jews have been taken from Jerusalem. They've been taken over to Babylon. And that was in two different sets. We had the first exiles taken out. Then we had the second set. And when it comes to return, it was not one return. It was actually three returns. We had first Zerubbabel. Now we have Ezra. And after that, we have Nehemiah. This is a period of over 100 years that took place when the people came back. Let's read here from the outline. A second group of exiles returned to Jerusalem in 458 BC under the leadership of Ezra, who had prepared himself by studying the rabbis in Babylon. His sole purpose of moving to Jerusalem was to begin teaching the Old Testament to the Jewish people. According to the Jewish sources, only some 1,500 Jewish men, along with their wives and children, returned to Jerusalem with a priest. So let's read Ezra chapter 7, and I'm going to pick it up in verse number 1. Now after these things, in the reign of Artaxerxes, king of Persia, Ezra, the son of Seraiah, the son of Azariah, the son of Hilkiah, and then in the next verses here, he gives his genealogy going all the way back to Aaron. Ezra was a Levite. He was a direct descendant of Aaron, the priest. In verse number 6, we read this. This Ezra went up from Babylon, and he was a ready scribe in the law of Moses, which the Lord God of Israel had given, and the king granted him all his requests according to the hand of the Lord, his God, upon him. Ezra now was a young man. He was most likely born in captivity. And he was born in the captivity. He must have had godly parents, and God must have touched Ezra, because as a young man, being of the tribe of Levi, he decided, I want to learn the Torah, the five books of Moses. I want to learn about 1st and 2nd Chronicles, 1st and 2nd Kings. I want to know what has happened in time past. So he dedicated his life. He studied hard. And he simply said, I'm going to go to Jerusalem, and I'm going to teach the people about God. Ezra was a man of God. He was not a Kabbalist, and he was genuine, and he simply dedicated his entire life, his youth, to learn the scriptures. And then he said, I'm going to go to Jerusalem, and I'm going to teach the people about God. He must have had contacts, because the king, Artaxerxes, was aware of Ezra, and he simply granted him all his requests. He put in requests. Let's go back and read verse number 7 now. And there went up some of the children of Israel, of the priests, and the Levites, and the singers, and the porters, and the Nethinims unto Jerusalem in the 7th year of Artaxerxes the king. Nethinims were simply people that worked in a temple. These were the janitors. They were called out to be janitors in the temple. And he came to Jerusalem in the 5th month, which was in the 7th year of the king. For upon the first day of the 1st month began it to go up from Babylon, and on the 1st day of the 5th month came into Jerusalem according to the good hand of his God upon him. Now Ezra was a man of God. He was motivated by the Holy Spirit. And he simply said, I'm going to do this the right way. In verse number 10, we read this. For Ezra had prepared his heart to seek the law of the Lord, and to do it and to teach in Israel's statutes and judgments. Now this is the copy of the letter that King Artaxerxes gave unto Ezra the priest, the scribe, even a scribe of the words of the commandment of the Lord, and of his statutes to Israel. We're going to look upon this letter here. This letter written 2,500 years ago, plus or minus. Artaxerxes, he was the king of Persia. He was not a believer in God, but he had a deep respect. The kings of Persia and the kings of Babylon remembered Daniel, who had lived under the time of Nebuchadnezzar. They had respect for the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. For some reason, they didn't want to be part of it, but they had respect. And this is what he wrote. Artaxerxes, verse number 12, King of kings, unto Ezra the priest, a scribe of the law of the God of heaven, perfect peace, and at such a time. I make a decree that all day of the people of Israel and of his priests and Levites in my realm, which are minded of their own free will to go up to Jerusalem, go with you. Notice now, here's a king that normally simply says, do this, do that, and there's total obedience. But I want you to catch this now. He said this, those Jews who wants to go by their own free will, let them go. God never pushes anyone. God wants to be you be saved. But he's not going to force you to be saved. God wants you to serve him. But he's not going to force you to serve him. God wants you to walk with him. But he's not going to force you. It's amazing that a king who was a dictator, he was a sovereign, he was supreme, he simply said, I'm not going to order the Jews to go back to Jerusalem. Those that want to go by their free will. Verse 14. For as much as you are sent of the king and of his seven counselors to inquire concerning Judah and Jerusalem, according to the law of your God, which is in your hand. This was written down 2,500 years ago. It has been preserved. God preserves his word. People over the years have tried to burn the Bibles, burn the Old Testament. They tried to put new translations in. But God's word will be there. It will be available. Verse 15. And to carry the silver and the gold, which the king and his counselor have freely offered to the God of Israel, whose habitation is in Jerusalem. Look in verse 15 now. Here's King Artaxerxes, a Persian, a pagan. He says, now, there's silver and gold, which I, the king, and his counselors have supplied. He simply gave silver and gold to whom? To the God of Israel. Who's that? That's the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That's God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Here's a heathen king simply saying this, I want to be part of this. And all the silver and the gold that you can find in the province of Babylon with the free will offering of the people and of the priest, offering willingly for the house of their God, which is in Jerusalem. So he said, now, there's going to be silver and gold. I'm going to supply that. Verse 17, that you may buy speedily with this money, bullocks, rams, lambs, with a meat offering and a drink offerings, and offer them upon the altar of the house of your God, which is in Jerusalem. Notice now, he said, not my God, but he said, your God. Isn't it amazing that a pagan king will give and supply to the living God? The sad thing is, he himself did not say, I want to serve this living God. Verse 18. And whatsoever shall seem good to you and to your brethren to do with the rest of the silver and the gold, that do after the will of your God. This is a fantastic write-up. He said, whatever shall seem good to you and to your brethren to do with the rest of the silver. In other words, he said, I am not going to say how you're going to do it. You have it. I give it to you. You take it. And today, you and I can simply be moving in the same type of activity. God will give us what we need. He will move upon people to bless us. The vessels also that are given you for the service of the house of God, those deliver you before the God of Jerusalem. And whatsoever more shall be needful for the houses of your God, which you shall have occasion to bestow it out of the king's treasure houses. This is a letter of credit. So the king Artaxerxes said, you know, if you need more stuff, you can have it. Verse 21, and I, even I, Artaxerxes, the king, do make a decree to all treasures which are beyond the river, that whatsoever Ezra the priest, the scribe of the law of the God of heaven, shall require of you, it be done speedily. This letter now told all the different governors in Syria, Samaria, and other places, Lebanon, at that time, that were under the king of Persia. Treasurers, whatever Ezra needs, you give him. But he put a limit on it. Unto 100 talents of silver, 200 measures of wheat, 200 baths of wine, and to 100 baths of oil and salt without prescribing how much. So now, I want you to think about this. 100 years earlier than this, God said, I'm going to punish Judah. Jerusalem destroyed, the people taken into captivity. 100 years later, God is simply saying this, I'm going to make a restoration. Notice now, not all Jews that were taken to Babylon returned. Only a few. 50,000 in the first round, about 1,500 in the second one. But God simply said this, I'm going to do a restoration. He does restoration in our lives. He does restoration with marriages. He will restore your life. He will change things up. He will give you supplies. He will call you into different positions. God is looking for men and women that willfully will return to him and say, I'm coming home, Jesus. I want to start over. Verse number 23. Whatsoever is commanded by the God of heaven, let it be diligently done for the house of the God of heaven. For why should there be wrath against the realm of the kings and his sons? Now the king is simply saying this. I know this God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. If I'm not in his good graces, he's going to judge me. And so he did this to please God. The sad thing is, a lot of people are doing things for God, but they are not walking with God. God wants to have a personal relationship with you. Also, we certify you that touching any other priest, the Levites, singers, porters, Nethinims, or minister of this house of God, it shall not be lawful to impose toll, tribute, or custom upon them. That's a nice little gesture. So the king said, now, when this group comes, you cannot exact, they have to pay a toll like you do for bridges. You drive over here in California, you got toll roads in the Midwest and the East. You cannot tax them, and there's no custom on their stuff. With other words, the king said, this group of people, 1,500 of them, don't tax them, don't take custom from them, simply leave them alone. They are special. Can God do that today? Yes, he can. He can make things special for you and me. He can make us to slide through things that it looks like we cannot do anything. God is simply able to do what he wants to do when he wants with his people. Verse 25. And you, Ezra, after the wisdom of your God, look at that. After the wisdom of your God that is in your hand, set magistrates, judges, which may judge all the people that are beyond the river, all such as know the laws of your God, and teach you them that know them not. Now, what he did was this. He simply said this. I'm going to make you the judge of Judah. You are going to be the judge. You are going to set the laws. You're going to set the statutes. Here now, we have the Jews returning. Here's Ezra, man of God. And he simply is told by the king, you set up a justice system. You write the laws. You rule Judah judicially. Look in verse 26 now. And whoso will not do the law of your God and the law of the king, let judgment be executed speedily upon him, whether it be unto death or to banishment or to confiscation of goods or to imprisonment. Here's Ezra now, a priest, but also a judge. And he's told, you are supreme. Whatever you rule will take place. There are Persian soldiers there. There are Jewish soldiers there. And they would carry it out. He even gave him the right for the death penalty. Most people are not really understood how great Ezra was. How extraordinary this was. Persia at this time was a powerful empire. They ruled the entire Middle East, up into India. They were not small potatoes, so to say. This is a strong empire. And the king of this empire simply talks to a captive group of people, Jews, and say, I'm going to bless you. We're going to send you back. We want you to prosper. God will use governments. He can use evil people to bless his people when need be. Now, Ezra, he knew how to praise God. Look upon verse 27 and 28. This is what Ezra said. Blessed be the Lord God of our fathers, which have put such a thing of this in the king's heart, to beautify the house of the Lord which is in Jerusalem, and has extended mercy unto me before the king and his counselors, and before all the king's mighty princes. He praised God. You know, the problem with us is this. Most Christians pray very seldom. I learned this over the years, that in most families, people don't pray over their food. People don't, you know, have a daily devotion. They don't have time for it, or they don't want to do it. And this goes in generation, from grandfather to father to son and to the next generation. People are prayerless. When do people pray? When they figured out, I got cancer. I have a car wreck. I lost my job. I got a crisis. What do we do then? We pray. And we expect God to be an ATM. Put in your code and then expect to have stuff coming out. And God is simply saying this. I am not an ATM. I am not Santa Claus. I am God Almighty. Come to me humble. Come to me asking. But most of all, come and love me. Some people children, never tell their parents, I love you. But they always said, you know, I want to have this, I want to have that. I want to go back on this. Let's look at them. Verse 27. Blessed be the Lord God of our fathers, which has put such a thing as this in the king's heart, to beautify the house of the Lord, which is in Jerusalem, and has extended mercy unto me before the king and his counselors, and before all the king's mighty princes. When was the last time you praised God for your home? When was the last time you praised God for your car? When was the last time you praised God for a good food that you had in front of you on the table? When was the last time that you said, God, thank you for a good marriage? Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Thank you for healing me. Thank you for walking with me. We are an unthankful people in the United States. We want this. We want lower taxes. We want cheaper gas. We want this. We want that. And we never really take the time and say, God, I'm going to give you 15 minutes of my time, full attention. And I don't want to ask you anything. I just want to say, God, I love you. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Holy Spirit. God is looking for that. When you tell God that you love him, we want to know that God loves us. But he wants to be loved back. And that's when he can truly bless you. And then the rest of the verse, it says this, and I was strengthened as the hand of the Lord my God was upon me. And I gathered together out of Israel chief men to go up with me. He was strengthened by God. He was strengthened by the love of God. Ezra was a very, very thankful man. Should we do the same? Absolutely. There's nothing worse for you and me. Let's say that you have somebody that you want to help out, and you give them money, give them food, or give them something, go to the house and says, I want you to have this. And the person simply says, what? You're giving me $200? Cheapskate? I'll need 1,000. No gracefulness. No grateful. If that happened to you, what would you do? If you bring food to somebody's house and you say, I cooked this food for you, and they says, I don't want food, I want cash. I heard people come to our church. We offer them food and clothing. They say, we don't want that, we want cash. It hurts. So what you do is you try to be nice. And you go out of your way to do something, and people spit upon you. They're not thankful. It means nothing. So what happened to you? You got angry. You got bitter. You says, I'm not going to do that again. Unthankful people, I let them drown. I'm not going to lift a finger for them. Here's Father God. And he said to give us things. And we says, God, I want more. I want this. I want that. And God said, you unthankful being. I'm not going to give you nothing. Praise, thankfulness is super important in the kingdom of God. If you want to have a relationship with God, start by saying, thank you, Lord. When you die, your body dies. You're not going to die, but the body dies. And you're the Christian. here comes holy angels, and they pick you up, and they take you to heaven, and they fly by, you can see hell on earth, underneath the earth. Are you going to be thankful? Are you going to say, oh, praise God. Whew, I didn't have to go to hell. I'm going to heaven. Yeah, you're thankful. But why not be thankful now for the little things? Chapter 8. I'm going to be right now probably on second page of my outline. Now, these are not the chiefs or the fathers, and these are the generation that went up with me from Babylon in the reign of Artaxerxes the king. And then he gave a list of all the men that went up and their genealogy. And I want us to look now at verse number 15. And I gathered them together to the river that runs to Ahava. And there abode we in tents 3 days. And I viewed the people and the priests and found that none of the sons of Levi's. Ezra was a very peculiar person. He was a very careful person. So he got 1,500 people, more or less, coming out with him. And he said, I'm not going to drag this group to Jerusalem. I want to know who's in the group. So he stopped at this place of Ahava, and he stayed there for 3 days. In your life, are you one of those people that simply keep running so fast that you can't even catch yourself? Or do you take an inventory and simply says, I'm going to look and see how my finances are. I'm going to look and see if this is what I want to do. I'm going to take an inventory of my life. I'm not just going to run head on. I want to know what I got so I can take care of things and ask God what I need further. I want you to see the heart of Ezra. This man was a revivalist. He said this, I want to bring my people to a relationship with God. I want them to be close to God. And as a shepherd, he was a priest. He said, I got 1,500 people here in a group, but I don't know who they are. I'm going to take 3 days, and I'm going to talk to everyone and find out, who are you? What's your purpose? What do you want to do in Jerusalem? How can I help you to be the most in the kingdom of God? He was a real pastor, not one of these that simply sell you the fleece, you know, and send me money, you know, we pray for you, send a prayer cloth, whatever it is. But he was caring for his people. When he found out he didn't have any Levites, he wanted some Levites. In verse number 16, then sent there for Eliezer, for Ariel, for Shemaiah, and for Nathan, and for Jerib, for Elnathan and for Nathan and for Zechariah and for Meshulam, chief men, also for Joarib and for Elnathan, men of understanding. He said this now, I'm going to get my leadership. I'm not going to get idiots. I'm going to get men that know what they are doing. And I sent them with commandment unto Iddo, the chief, at the place of Casiphia. And I told them what they should say unto Iddo and to his brethren, the Nethinims, at the place of Casiphia, and that they should bring unto us ministers for the house of our God. He said, this is what I need. He took the chief men that were wise, and he simply said, you go, talk to the priest, Iddo, find out, and bring back to me so we can augment this group and have everything we need of. And by the good hand of our God upon us, they brought us a man of understanding of the sons of Mahli, the sons of Levi, the son of Israel, Sherebiah, with his sons and his brethren, 18. So he got 18 men of quality. And Hashabiah, and with him, Yeshaya, and the son of Merari, his brethren, and their sons, there were 20. And also the Nethinims, whom David and the prince had appointed for the service of the Levites, 220 Nethinims. All of them were expressed by name. In other words, each one had been selected by name. So Ezra now said, okay, I got the people I need. I got the leadership. What did he do next? He did something that most Christians in America don't even know what it is. Fasting. Why do you want to fast? Well, some people fast when they have a crisis. You should fast when you have a good time. Then I proclaimed a fast there at the river of Ahava, that we might afflict ourselves before God, to seek of him a right way for us, and for our little ones, and for all our substance. Let's go through that verse again. That's so rich. If you want to have a program, why you should fast? Then I proclaimed a fast there at the river of Ahava, that we might afflict ourselves before God. It simply means humbling yourself. They put ashes on themselves and so on. And they said, God, we're going to take time. I'm going to slow down. I'm not going to do anything. I'm going to sit here and I'm going to simply fast and talk to you. Because we need to know the right way. You says, well, I want direction in my life. Well, if you want to know what God wants for you, have a time of fasting. It can be a day, it can be 2 days, you can fast a meal, whatever it is. But simply say, I need to hear from God. I'm serious. Fasted for our little ones. That's for the children. Ezra was thinking about the next generation. And that's what was happening in this country. We have sent the children to public schools. And they have developed them into evil spirits, more or less. They're coming back. Don't believe in God. Don't believe in the Bible. They are heathens. That's what this nation has done. And for all our substance. Ezra said, I know, I got a letter from the king. I got silver and gold. I'm a judge. I got all kind of authority. I'm a big shot. When I come to Judah, to Jerusalem, I mean, I'm going to be top dog. He knew that. He had the authority. But instead, he humbled himself and said, I'm a servant. I will use my authority to further the kingdom of God, not to enrich myself. And then in verse number 22, it's fantastic. He says, for I was ashamed to require the kings a band of soldiers and horsemen to help us against the enemy in the way, because we had spoken unto the king, saying, the hand of our God is upon all them for good that seek him. But his power and his wrath is against all them that forsake him. Ezra said, man, we're going to have to live what we believe. He said, I told the king, hey, God is able to supply. God is able to protect us. And then he goes to the king and says, by the way, king, can I have about 500 soldiers to protect us? And the king said, I thought your God was doing that. Well, you know, God might not always show up. So can we have a little bit insurance? Ezra said, I was ashamed. I'm not going to ask Artaxerxes for soldiers. When I told him that my God is able to supply all my needs according to his riches and glory. This is where we should be. We should simply have faith in God. But you know, if you don't read the Bible, and if you don't have prayer time, and in your daily life you don't really read the Bible, there's no prayer time, there's no talking about God and so on, you're just busy. You're not going to have the faith. You're not going to have nothing. It's going to be a drag. It's so much easier if you walk in the Holy Spirit. Verse 23. So we fasted and besought our God for this, and he was entreated of us. I like that. So they fasted, they prayed, and God said, you got it, Ezra. I will protect you. I will honor your faith. Verse 24. Ezra now simply said, I'm not going to be in charge of the gold and the silver. I am going to delegate that. It would have been so simple for Ezra to simply say, well, I have some servants. I carry the gold and then, you know, sneak a little bit off that, a little bit of the silver, put it in his own pocket. But in order for him to be above reproached, in verse 24, then I separated 12 of the chief of the priests, Sherebiah, Hashabiah, and 10 of their brethren with them, and weighed unto them the silver and the gold and the vessels, even the offering of the house of our God, which the king and his counselor and his lords and all Israel, their present, had offered. So, in other words, he says, I am not going to have my hand in the till. I even weighed unto their hand 650 talents of silver, and silver vessels 100 talents, and a gold 100 talents. And 20 bases of gold and 1,000 drams, 2 vessels of fine copper, precious as gold. And I said unto them, you are holy unto the Lord. The vessels are holy also, and the silver and the gold are a freewill offering unto the Lord God of your fathers. Watch you, and keep them until you weigh them before the chief of the priests and the Levites, and the chief of the fathers of Israel at Jerusalem, in the chambers of the house of the Lord. So took the priests and the Levites the weight of the silver and the gold and the vessels to bring them to Jerusalem unto the house of our God. Ezra simply said, no one is going to accuse me of embezzling. I'm going to have some solid men. They will take care of the gold and the silver and the vessels. They will carry that. I am not going to touch it. Back in 1972, as I was transitioning from seminary to become an evangelist, I made a decision. And that decision, I want to share this with you. When I was growing up in Sweden, and all the way up to I was about left to come into the United States, I was a thief, I was a liar, I was a cheat, I was a coward. I mean, I was a pretty nasty guy. After I rededicated my life in 1965 and joined the church in 1966, I made a decision, God moved upon me, and I simply said this, I'm going to rebuild myself. I don't like myself. So I selected out different people that I felt had integrity. We had come back to Christ at the Billy Graham. I felt he was a man of integrity. I'd listened to Catherine Kuhlman. I liked her teaching. I liked the way that she was handling the Word of God, so I took some of her. So I picked probably 10 to 15 different men and women of their characteristics and said, I want this, I want that, I want this. And I said, God, rebuild me. And He did. I don't lie, I don't cheat. I'm a different person. I've been a different person for years. It's not because of me, but I realized that I had to rebuild myself if I was going to be a minister of the gospel. One of the things I did was, I said this, I'm not going to be like so many of the other big evangelists. They simply stuff the money in the pocket, you know, and they have no accountability. So we had a little board of directors, and they set the salary for me. And whenever I was out preaching, whatever offering we took, I would put it in an envelope, I'd bring it to the treasurer, and put it into the ministry. And then I was paid out a salary. For years, I refused to sign checks. I'm not going to sign any checks. So for years, I couldn't sign a check. Now, because we are a few people, they forced me to be able to sign. So they, but I usually don't sign checks. I don't like to do that. And this was Ezra. He was a man of such a character. And he rebuilt his life. And then we read here, if we finish up this chapter. Then we departed from the river of Ahava on the 12th day of the first month to go into Jerusalem. And the hand of God was upon us. He delivered us from the hand of the enemy and of such as lay in wait by the way. Hey, people around the way, they heard the rumors. Here comes Ezra and a few Jews. They got gold, they got silver. Hey, let's go and liberate that silver. It was known. But here's the thing. God protected them. I want to tell you this. For years, I was afraid of the dark. I've been abused as a child by relatives where they would dress up like ghosts and scare the daylight out of me. And there was a day, but probably 1976, 77. I was now in my 40s. And I was going to go down to my church office. We had a big facility. Downstairs, upstairs, no windows. We were in a warehouse. And driving down, I could feel the fear come on me. Demons came in. And Septa said, you know what? Your secretary is not down there. There's no one in the house, in the building. You don't want to go in there. And I could feel the hair standing up on my back. And I, you know, if you ever had demonic activity around you, you know what I'm talking about. It's the cold chill. So I said, well, no, I'm going to go in. And this is what I did. Parked my car, opened the door. We had lights, what you call the night lights of the building. I said, I'm not going to turn any lights on. I'm going to go from room to room all the way up to the top into the most, where we had a print shop. And I'm going to go from room to room and drive out the demons. And when I first got in, my hair was standing out, and that, you know, I could feel the powers of the demons. And I said, get out of here. And I just walked from room to room. When I was done, I had defeated fear. I have never had fear since that time. You got to face it. You got to push on it. And this is what Ezra had. He simply said this: if we prayed for God for this, we told the king that, hey, king, we don't need your soldiers, then I'm going to have to do this in faith. Did God honor Ezra? Yes, he did. He honored him 100%. Would God honor you? Yes, if you walk in integrity. And we came to Jerusalem, and I abode there 3 days. Now on the fourth day was the silver and the gold and the vessels weighed in the house of our God by the hand of Meremoth, the son of Uriah the priest. And with him was Eleazar, the son of Phinehas. And with him was Josabad, the son of Jeshua, and Noadiah, the son of Binu, Levites. By the number and by the weight of every one, and all the weight was written at that time. With other words, they come into Jerusalem, they had a paperwork and said, this is how much we got for the king. They waited in, and this is exactly what they gave to the people that had to take care of the temple. There was no graft, no taking a little bit of money for this or that. It was all integrity, truth. Also the children of those that have been carried away, which will come, I'm in verse 20, 35 now, which will come out of the captivity, offer burnt offerings unto the God of Israel, 12 bullocks for all Israel, 96 rams, 77 lambs, 12 he-goats for a sin offering. All this was a burnt offering unto the Lord. And they delivered the king's commissions unto the king's lieutenants and to the governors on this side of the river. And they furthered the people and the house of God. Ezra arrived in style. What did he do after they weighed the silver and the gold? Worship, praise, worship, praying, thanking God. That's what we're missing today. And after that, then he delivered the different written letters to the different people in charge and said, these are my credentials, and I'm here now. I'm in charge of Jerusalem. Let's wrap this message up in a summary, because that's the farthest I'm going to go today. Ezra was a young man. When he was about maybe 17 or 18 years old, he said this: I am going to be a man of God. I'm going to learn the Torah, the 5 books of Moses. I'm going to learn the Old Testament. I'm going to know it on my 5 fingers, on my 10 fingers. And when I have been ordained and I have studied and they set me apart, I will go to Jerusalem and I will teach the people the way of God. This is what God needs today, men and women, boys and girls, that are simply saying this: I'm not going to pursue my personal goals, what I like. I'm going to ask God, you made me? What's my purpose? What do you want me to do? Because in ourselves, we got ideas. I want to do this. I want to go here, do that. But have you really asked God, God, what do you want me to do? God has called some people to become medical doctors. Others are called to be lawyers. Some may be called to be pastors, evangelists, missionaries, plumbers. God has people everywhere. But you want to find out, if you are very gifted as a musician, God does not put you down to be a plumber. God will place you according to your talents. He knows what he put in you. It's just like you buy a computer. You load it up with the programs you want. And that computer's doing what you want. You can have different programs than computer. All of us got different programs. Ezra found out what he wanted to be. And Ezra was a man of God that was used to bring Jesus, the origin story of Jesus, from all the way from Abraham, all the way to the time when Jesus came to live here on this earth. And Ezra was part of that. How long did he live? We don't know. He might have lived 60, 70, 80 years. Did he succeed in teaching the people of Judah? Yes, at that time he did. They got rid of their paganism. And they worshiped the Lord. He fulfilled his position. When he died, he went to paradise. And after Jesus was resurrected and went back to heaven, Ezra and the rest of the people from the Old Testament went up to heaven. And Ezra now is walking around in heaven. And he's simply saying this, I was just a simple young man. God called me to be a priest. I did what God told me to do. I lived my life. I finished the fight. I completed what God wanted me to do. He's thankful today. He's simply walking to heaven and saying, you know, praise God, you know, I fulfilled what I was made to be. And that's what you want to do. Find out who you are, what you're supposed to do. And I said, God, help me to be in your calling. I want to close the scriptures here today. I'm going to go to 1 John. This is a bonus scripture. 1 John. Chapter 1. We got the 1 John, I'm doing good. And I'm going to read from verse, let me start in verse number 5. This then is a message you heard of him and clear to you, that God is light. And in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. But if we walk in the light as he's in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins. And to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. Focus on verse number 9. If we confess our sins, he, God, is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Some of you are on the older side. You might be in your 40s or 50s or 60s, whatever. And you said, well, I never really asked God what he wanted me to be. What do I do? Well, number one, simply stop and say, God, I want to repent. Father God, forgive me that in my youth, I did not seek you. I'm sorry. I'm seeking you now. I don't know how many years I got left. But whatever years I got left, Lord, let me be in your perfect will. Let me do exactly what you want me to do. God will hear that prayer. He will move upon you. And you can have the greatest time. It might be 10 years. 30 years or 40 years, whatever, 5 years. But you will have the greatest time on your life, and you will redeem what you lost. Understand that? So simply say, God, forgive me. I want you to cleanse me with the blood of Jesus. You're already saved, but you want a special cleansing. And Lord, I don't know how many years you're going to give me, but I want to use my remaining years on this earth to walk with you. He will take you, and you will have a fantastic life. And you can be like Ezra when he came up into heaven and saying, I praise God, I turn around. And you can just be as blessed. If you watch me today and you're not saved, and you says, you know, I've never heard stuff like this before. Well, you know that you need God. You know that you're a sinner. And all you have to do is just simply say this, God, I am sorry. I am a sinner. I made too many mistakes. I've done too many bad things. Please forgive me. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. I believe that Jesus died on the cross, rose on the third day, and through his death and resurrection, I can be saved. Come on in, Jesus. Come on in, Jesus, and save me. And he will. If you pray that prayer, when we finished here, the screen will change on your computer, or on your whatever you're watching on. You will see three crosses coming up. You will hear the voice of Pastor Charles Torell saying, my friend. And then he will take you through the plan of salvation. Stay with him. Pray the final prayer with him. And be saved today. And if you do that, would you contact us afterwards? We'd like to encourage you. We'd like to talk to you, pray with you over the phone or whatever. But let us know in the name of Jesus. And to those of you that are walking with the Lord, take an inventory today. How is your prayer life? Hello? How is your prayer life? Are you in God's will? If you are, praise him. But if you're not, would you say today, God, I want to repent. I want you to tell me what to do the rest of my life on this earth. God bless you as you make that decision. Here's Brother Sotiris to close.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this message that you gave us through the pastor. Oh Lord, let us examine ourselves, we pray, in the name of Jesus. Search us and know our hearts, try us and know our thoughts. There will be no wicked way in us, and lead us into life everlasting, we pray in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Heavenly Father, that let the day something wonderful happen, we pray in the name of Jesus. Fill each and every one of us and those that watch us with the knowledge of thy will, in all wisdom, a spiritual understanding, that we may walk worthy of the Lord, unto all pleasing, and be fruitful in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Let this lesson become a lesson to us, we pray, Father. Let it go deep in our hearts and want to do the best that we want to be, O Lord, the people that will give a good example, that our light will shine before men, that they may see our good works and glorify the Father which is in heaven. We thank you and praise you, Heavenly Father, O Lord, for also using us, O Lord, using us to reach out to the lost, to those, O Lord, who do not know you, Lord. Let us be people that can make a difference. It doesn't matter what's going on around the country, around the world, O Lord. O Lord, you have a different agenda for us. O Lord, we want to make a difference. We want to see people be saved, that your name be glorified. We want to see, O Lord, that we'll win. would be victorious in Christ Jesus. Oh, thank you, Heavenly Father. Thank you, Lord. Starting with me, O Lord, search me today and know my heart also. I pray in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. And let the high praises of God always be in our mouth and the two-edged sword in our hands. Thank you, Father. Let us be grateful, Lord, for the wonderful things that you've done in our lives. Grateful, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Father. And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. And we want to thank you and praise you, Heavenly Father. Oh, Lord, thank you, Lord. We give you all the praise, Lord. We give you all the glory, all the honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person, doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything, even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7 through 8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us, in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send his Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through his Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." You see, God offers his love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, he will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, he will do for you. If you call out to him, he will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All he wants for you is to come to him. He will help anybody who calls out to him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, he will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and he has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Torell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever. You've been listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Torell. This message was the 82nd part in the series, The Origin Story of Jesus, and was entitled, The Man of God. Ezra's parents must have been godly people because their son loved the Lord. He was raised in captivity and wanted to become a priest so he could travel to Jerusalem to reestablish the rabbinical system and restore the Torah teaching to the people. King Artaxerxes I commissioned Ezra to aid in the rebuilding of the temple and set up the justice system in Judea. To that end, the king sent a dispatch with him that served as a letter of authority and a letter of credit. This took place before Artaxerxes issued a moratorium on rebuilding the temple. Ezra stopped the small caravan to fast and ask God for protection because their group carried a lot of gold and silver for the temple. They didn't take any of the king's soldiers for protection, trusting only that God would see them through unmolested, and that is exactly what happened. Ezra was a godly man, and the remnant that returned was blessed to have him as their leader. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1877. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.